Come on, everybody, clap your hands right here. We're going to have a little old school church right here. Is that all right? Somebody make some noise. I got a little help. Trisha Green, won't you tell them how you feel about it? Say it. Come on, give God the praise. Come on and give God the praise. Everybody give God the praise. Trish, tell them one more time how you feel about it.
Thank you. Good morning, St. Luke, for this is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We got the musicians hanging out this morning on Sunday morning with us. Here we go. Let's play. Come on and sing along with us. All of my life, you remain the same. All of my life, you remain the same. All of my life, you remain the same. Wonderful. I've never known. You remain. Here we go, let's walk it out. You woke me up and you started with food and you brought joy. I'm so glad. Your love never changed. Wonderful. Wonderful. Wonderful is. All right, you got it. Now let's sing it. All of my life, I've never known. You remain. And all of my life, thank God for his consistency. Come out. You woke. Started me on my way. Put food and you brought joy. I'm so glad. Your love has never changed. And let's do it again. You woke. And you brought joy. I'm so glad. And wonderful. And one more time. Come on, Josh. Come on and testify. I'm so glad. Your love has never changed. And wonderful. And wonderful. Come on and put your hands on it. Yep. Come on and play, Josh. That's it. What you got, King? Hey, yeah. Come on, Hames. Is that your testimony? Yep. For the rest of my life, I've got to serve him. For the rest. For the rest, for the rest. I'll serve him. For the rest of my life. For the rest. I've got a servant. That's it. Can we mix it up? Here we go. Here we go. That's it. That was nice. Can we do it again? For the rest of my life. For the rest, I'll serve him. Let's go out. Let's testify. You woke me up and started good food, and you brought joy. I'm so glad. Wonderful, wonderful is wonderful. Come on, call him wonderful. The Lord is kind and wonderful. Come on and put your hands together. Hallelujah. Come on, he's wonderful. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Good morning, everyone. My name is Cliff Matthews, and I'm the proud pastor of the St. Luke Missionary Baptist Church, located here in Charlotte, North Carolina. If you are a first-time worshiper with us today, we want to say welcome to our Sunday morning worship. We want to ask that you take a few moments, register your presence by typing into the comment section, first-time worshiper, first-time visitor. We thank you in advance for that. And to all of you who are returning members of the St. Luke, of the St. Luke tribe, welcome back home and thanks in advance for all that you do. You know how we do church. We want you to share this link on your page, invite someone to come to church with you today. And we also want you to stay engaged throughout the worship service by either typing in the comment section or sending an emoji our way. This is the last Sunday in August in the church calendar. That means summer is almost over, and we're looking forward to what God has for us in the fall. But today, I want to bring you a message out of the Gospel of Luke, and I want to give another look at the person of Jesus. Well, beloved, this is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Anybody came to give him glory this morning? Come on, St. Luke. Down at the cross. Down where from cleansing. There to my heart. And I'm singing glory. Come on, let's give him glory. To the only name that matters. His precious name. There to my heart. And I'm singing glory. And the second verse, I am saved from sin. Jesus so sweetly there at the cross. Glory. Come on, church, we're singing glory. We're singing glory. Then to my heart was the blood applied, and we're singing glory. Come on, let's take a little bit higher. Come. There we can cast our poor souls. Come on, let's plunge in today and be made complete. And we're singing glory. Oh, that's it. Come on and put your hands on it. Singing glory. We're singing glory. His name. Oh, there. To my heart. And we're singing glory. I'm singing glory. I'm singing glory.
Amen. At this time, beloved, I invite you to join in with me, please, as together we confess our sin against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy upon us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. This we ask in the name of Jesus, our Savior, who has taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Beloved, rest in the promise of Scripture. If we confess our sin, our God is faithful and just to forgive us our sin and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. And to that the church said, Amen.
Welcome back to the St. Luke News Network. I'm MJ3. These are your notices and announcements for the month of August 2021. We invite you back for virtual Bible study. Virtual Bible study is a time to enjoy God's Word every noon right here on Facebook Live. Virtual Bible study, of course, is led by our senior pastor, Reverend Clifford Matthews. So come on back right here to Facebook Live at 12 noon on Tuesdays for virtual Bible study. This is the time and service where we like to welcome our visitors. If you are visiting with us today, take a moment to write in the comments section where you're visiting from so we can show you some St. Luke love. Also, to all of our visitors and returning members, make sure you check us out on Facebook. Our Facebook group is called Members of St. Luke. This is where you can share a testimony, share your prayer requests, or just connect with all your members and friends at St. Luke. It's a new month, so it's time to celebrate those August birthdays. Happy birthday from your friends at St. Luke. But we're also celebrating whatever special occasion you're celebrating this month. So if that's an anniversary or whatever it is, happy celebration, happy anniversary, happy birthday from your members and friends of St. Luke. Thank you so much for joining us for this edition of the St. Luke News Network. Before I go, let me remind you to like us right here on Facebook and subscribe to our YouTube channel at www.youtube.com/St. Luke CLT. That concludes this edition of the St. Luke News Network. We'll see you next week.
Anybody feeling blessed this morning? Consider all the things that God has done for us. And let's testify and say, everybody say, bless, bless, bless. Everybody say, bless, bless, bless. Everybody say, bless, bless, bless. Everybody say, bless, bless. We're blessed. We're blessed, we're blessed. We're blessed in the city. We're blessed in the fields. We're blessed when we come and when we go. We cast down every stronghold. Sickness and poverty must mustn't see. For the devil is defeated. We are blessed, we're blessed in the city. We're blessed when we come and when we go. We cast down sickness and poverty. For the devil is. We are blessed. Come on and type right there, blessed. I'm blessed. I'm blessed. Amen. We are so blessed and thankful that you have stayed with us so far in worship today. And we want to ask and remind you that you still have an opportunity to invite someone to join us for church today. And we hope that you would do that. We hope that something has already been said or done that has helped you on your journey. Well, beloved, today I want to continue bringing to you our mission focus for the month of August. What is the goal behind this mission focus, Pastor? It is to highlight the fact that we are more than just a Sunday church and that we are doing the work that Christ will have us to do 24/7 right here in our community and around the world because of what you do week after week. And today we have a special treat. I hope you will tune in to this video. I'll see you when it's over. You're going to enjoy it. Thanks. Good morning, everybody. Cliff Matthews, pastor of St. Luke Missionary Baptist Church. And today I am proud to have joining me for our mission focus, Mr. Jarvis Miller. Jarvis Miller is the church administrator here at St. Luke. But today he's here to talk about a collaboration between Digital, Charlotte, Queens University, and the St. Luke Missionary Baptist Church, which is, of course, more than a Sunday church. Mr. Miller is currently working with a group that is committed to providing digital literacy to communities that are underserved. Prior to the pandemic, we all knew that neighborhoods of color had what they call a digital divide, that in more affluent neighborhoods, access to the internet was more prevalent than it was in communities of color. When the pandemic hit, we saw that firsthand. With the inability of some of our children to access the internet, families to stay connected. So to help deal with that, this group, in collaboration with St. Luke, has decided to really do a training, you would say, to really help persons in our community navigate the digital divide, to develop digital literacy, which is absolutely important today. So, Mr. Miller, thank you for joining us today. Tell us, why is it so important that our community has digital literacy?
So, especially with COVID being an issue right now, you can't be around your friends, your family. You can't really even go to the doctor. So it's important that you know how to actively work a computer and be confident in working a computer.
So digital literacy, like English literacy, is really about helping persons know how to do something, right?
Correct.
And what you're saying is that because of COVID, now many persons will have to see a doctor via the computer, apply for jobs via computer, work a job, perhaps via computer. And without digital literacy, what you're saying is that the difficulties, the economic and the health challenges can be exacerbated. Is that right?
That's correct.
Okay. So tell me, why are you passionate about this?
So especially like seeing people I love being so disconnected from everything, because everything has gone from like in person, shaking hands, loving you, loving on your family in person, Thanksgiving, Christmas, holidays. Mm-hmm. And I feel like they are missing out.
I hear you.
Just even church, mm-hmm. some of the people that are here every Sunday have missed church for months, over a year. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So I feel like it's my duty, in a way, to try to assist them to be able to be a part of what we're doing in the digital world.
Wow. we had anticipated being out of this, back in church, and that being over, but it looks like this is our new reality, right? Right. And so what your passion is, you're saying it's about making sure that if we stayed in this situation longer than we even can imagine now, you want to make sure that people are able to connect. That's right. Important, right? Mm-hmm. From a mental health perspective, that connectivity is a definite plus when it comes to dealing with depression and anxiety. When people feel isolated, bad things tend to happen.
Absolutely.
So tell us, is there a particular demographic that you all are trying to reach?
Absolutely. So from ages 50 and above.
Okay.
And I just want you to know, don't be discouraged mm-hmm. about trying something new, because we're going to start at the ground level and we're going to build you up until you feel comfortable, right?
Okay. Right.
So not only are we doing stuff like Zoom, where you can call your grandchild or your daughter or your son and you can communicate, you can see their faces and not always like through the screen door.
Mm-hmm.
I'll teach you basic things about the computer. So mm-hmm. you'll know how to create folders, how to save pictures on your computer, how to shop on your computer. Shopping, believe it or not, online shopping has gone up because people don't want to go to grocery stores. Mm-hmm. They want to order your list of supplies online and just go to the store and they load it into your car.
Mm-hmm. So is there a fee involved for this course?
No, it's completely free. It's completely free.
Free, okay. So where would it be held?
It'll be held here in the multi-purpose room.
Okay. So what you may not know, or I forgot, is that we do have a state-of-the-art computer lab that is still functioning. People can still come. We limit capacity in there, of course. But on top of that, because of Mr. Miller's work with the community, we will also have an opportunity to have more computers brought in. So the class size is going to be about 10 individuals. There will be social distancing, and if there are more than 10 people sign up, there is the possibility that you may get put on a waiting list or another class can be started. This is an excellent time for children to get their parents and grandparents engaged with this. This is an excellent time for older couples to come out and get engaged with this. This is a wonderful opportunity for you to better understand how to navigate this digital reality that we're in, because it's necessary, not only for worship, but for your health, for being able to shop, being able to stay connected to family. So, Mr. Miller, any parting words you want to say about this program?
So you have the opportunity now to contact me directly. My telephone number is 864-684-8773, and it'll be on the screen at the bottom. Please, 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 please take advantage of this opportunity.
Wow.
It's so important. Mm-hmm. And I know people in this mindset that we are going back. We're not going back, not fully anyway.
Mm.
You have to know how to use a computer.
Good, good. Well, St. Luke, you know what we say, hashtag St. Luke Proud. Again, thank you, Mr. Miller, for being here. Thank you, St. Luke, for allowing us to collaborate with Digital Charlotte and Queens University to do this important work. But we can only do it because of you. St. Luke Proud, God loves you, and so do I. Well, hashtag St. Luke Proud. I told you you would enjoy that. St. Luke, you are making a difference in the lives of many. Throughout this pandemic, you have not stopped bearing witness that Jesus loves persons, and there is a hope that we have in him. So thanks in advance again for all that you will do. Thank you for all that you have done. You ought to know I am forever St. Luke Proud. I hope that you are, and I hope that you will light up Facebook now and in the days to come, hashtag St. Luke Proud. Be proud of your church. We're doing great work, and it's all because of you. Well, beloved, at this time, I want to encourage you to get ready for church in prayer, and I want us to continue to lift up those who are in need of special prayer. I want to lift up persons who I know or who I have heard from, persons who are in need of special prayer. I want to lift up our seasoned saints. I cannot call them all by name. I want to lift up today Sister Patsy June, ask God to continue to give her strength. I want to lift up Sister Virginia Gaston, ask God to continue to bless her. Sister Gerald Oliver, Deacon and Mother Bradley. I want to lift up Joanna. I want to lift up Sister Dorothy Green. I can't keep calling names because I'll miss somebody and somebody will get upset. But I want us just to pray for them. Pray for our mission leaders. Pray for those who have given so much to help us continue along the way. I lift up Sister Teen. I lift up those in the kitchen, Sister Welch. I lift them up. Those who continue to help us week after week serve this present age. Well, beloved, you have an opportunity now to put your prayer requests in the comment section. I hope that you do. And after we have been led in a preparation song, I will come back and lead us to God's throne of grace. Let us pray. Dear God, in whom we live and move and have our being, how thankful we are for this another day to come before you and to lift up your name and to offer prayers in that name. Dear God, we thank you for all that you've already done. We praise you for who you are and forever will be. And dear God, we bring now our petitions before you. Dear God, you see the petitions that were listed on Facebook. You know them already. And you know the persons whose names we called out and the countless others we could not call out. Dear God, have mercy. Bless, heal, deliver, strengthen as only you can. Dear God, we ask you to show favor. Continue to show yourself real. Continue to be exalted in the midst of life's trials and difficulties. Dear God, we praise you for life. We praise you for a reasonable portion of health. We thank you for all that you've already done, not only in delivering us in the past, but in sustaining us today and even tomorrow.
Dear God, our time here upon this earth is always limited. But in the days that we have, help us to continue to lift our eyes to you, to trust you for our everything. Dear God, we need you. We love you. And we thank you in the name of Jesus. And now, dear God, we ask your blessing upon this world, upon this country, upon our leader. Dear God, we pray that you will continue to show yourself real. We are thankful that you are God bigger than religion, God that's bigger than the Christian faith. And dear God, even in countries who call you by another name, we give you praise that you are still yet at work. And dear God, we thank you for this church called St. Luke. Dear God, continue to let your light shine upon this place. Continue to call us to higher heights and to greater levels of service. Dear God, thank you for a church that really believes that mission work matters. And thank you for the lives we are touching day after day. And dear God, have your way. Bless the furtherance of our worship service. Don't let us leave where we are, having been in your presence, and not be changed. This is the prayer we ask in Jesus' name. And all God's children said, Amen. Come on, you deserve it. Come on, say hallelujah. 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 All the glory, all the honor, all the praise. You deserve it. You deserve it. Highest praise belongs to you. My hallelujah. It belongs. Hallelujah.
come on, and is seated in majesty. Come on, say, how great. Come on and sing with me. All will see. Our God. One more time, how great is our God. How great, yeah, for the name. Come on, you're worthy. And my heart will sing. There's no God like our God. You are worthy. And my heart, our God. Come on, death cannot hold. You are. Come on, he's seated. One more time. Come on, hallelujah. One more time. Hallelujah.
Amen. Today I want to invite your attention for the sermon, please, to the Gospel according to Luke. Luke chapter number 6, starting in verse number 6. And I'm reading today from the New Revised Standard Version of the Bible, where you will find these words. On another Sabbath, he entered the synagogue and taught. And there was a man there whose right hand was withered. The scribes and the Pharisees watched him to see whether he would cure on the Sabbath, so they might find an accusation against him. Even though he knew what they were thinking, he said to the man who had the withered hand, "Come and stand here." He got up and stood there. Then Jesus said to them, "I ask you, is it lawful to do good or to do harm on the Sabbath, to save life or to destroy it?" After looking around at all of them, he said to him, "Stretch out your hand." He did so, and his hand was restored. But they were filled with fury and discussed with one another what they might do to Jesus. After looking around at all of them, he said, "Stretch out your hand." He did so, and his hand was restored. With the help of God, I want to preach for the next few moments from the subject, "Withered Hands Are Welcomed." Withered hands are welcomed. Let us pray. Father, where I am, you brought me. What I know, you taught me. What I have, you gave me. And what I am, Lord, you made me. Lord, I'm depending on you. Can't do nothing till you come. This is your servant's prayer. I ask it in Jesus' name. And all God's children said, amen. Withered hands are welcomed. Today I want to focus on this miracle of Jesus. Because in my own devotion, as I began to wrestle with this text, I thought it would be something worthwhile for the pulpit. The context of this miracle is that Jesus had been engaged in conversation, I would say conflict, with the scribes and the Pharisees concerning what was proper and what was improper to do on the Sabbath. In the previous story in chapter 6 of Luke's gospel, it had to do with whether one could pluck grain when hungry on the Sabbath, or was that going too far? Jesus reminded those religious persons that David did pluck grain on the Sabbath, and it was all right. Now we come to this story of ours, the story for our sermon today. And Jesus is dealing with another controversy on another Sabbath day. For Jewish religion, Sabbath was a day of rest. It was a day not so much to sleep in late, but a day for one to remember who God was. It was a time for Israel to remember the Creator, who, after making the heavens and the earth, rested on the seventh day. The Sabbath was a time to reflect, a time to be renewed, a time to recenter one's self in who God was. The Sabbath, sundown on Sunday to sundown on Saturday, was a major focus of Jewish religion in the time of Jesus. So concerned was Israel about keeping the Sabbath that they built a wall, as it were, a fence around the Sabbath. This fence was found in rabbinical teachings and traditional teachings that in essence put a guard against the Sabbath. So that if keeping the Sabbath is a requirement of God, they put barriers around the Sabbath, so that if you broke the barriers, you still wouldn't break the Sabbath. Sabbath was an important concept for Israel. And it's not surprising that Jesus comes along, and early in his ministry, conflict comes around the importance of the Sabbath. The real question had to do with, was Sabbath made for man or man made for Sabbath? Was Sabbath a day that is to be a burden to humanity? Or was Sabbath a day that was intended to bless humanity? Was it to be a legal requirement that became, in essence, something that was almost dreaded by some? Or is there something bigger than the day, perhaps God and God's graciousness, that ought to be considered on Sabbath? Jesus comes along, and Jesus, as this teacher of grace and love, understood that the Sabbath itself was no, how can I say this, guarantee that one was in right relationship with God. That one may honor the Sabbath, but miss God by a mile. Jesus began to teach contrary to the teachings of the scribes and the Pharisees. And so we have on another Sabbath, Jesus is showing that what is of more importance is not the keeping of the day, but that on this day, there ought to be some help for those who are hurting. He arrives at synagogue, as was his custom. And there was in the synagogue a brother who had a withered hand. We're not told what caused the withering, whether it was a birth defect or whether it was the result of an accident, perhaps a stroke. Who knows? We're not told. What we are told, however, is that the brother had a withered hand, and in Luke's gospel, that hand was the right hand. The right hand was the hand that was used to function, to work. The left hand was the hand in this culture that was used to clean oneself, if you get what I'm saying. It was a hand that was not necessarily a prideful hand, but one associated with shame. Here was this brother. Now that his right hand was withered, now that it would not function as it used to or should have, now this brother had to use his left hand. And that was to exacerbate not only his immobile right hand, but to highlight the shame associated with his left hand. Let me pause here now and talk for myself. As somebody who's a proud left-hander, I'm glad we don't live in a context today where left hand is considered bad and ugly and shameful. I'm glad we have matured enough that we no longer make children use their right hand when you see them using their left hand. I'm glad we live in a day now where we understand that what some call shame is associated with creativity and talent. Beloved, the brother had a withered right hand. He was unable to function and do what he had to do in the cultural context of his day. And it was a Sabbath. Give the brother credit. He showed up on the Sabbath, even though his right hand was withered. It is not known if he came to synagogue because he heard about the teachings of Jesus or that Jesus was present. Maybe he was just like many of you who Sunday after Sunday come to worship, no matter what you're going through, because God is worthy of our worship even when we have withered conditions. The brother had a withered right hand, and the crowd gathered. The Pharisees and the scribes were looking because they know that Jesus was this radical preacher of grace, and somehow he would, if he had a chance, do something to break the Sabbath law. He knew what they were thinking, the text tells us. But he called the brother and said, stand here. Then Jesus raises the question. He asked the question, is it lawful to do good or to do harm on the Sabbath? Question one. Question two, to save life or destroy it. Now, if you are a farmer and you had a cattle, an ox, that fell into the ditch, you could pull that cattle out on Sabbath. But if a brother had a physical deformity, you couldn't help him on the Sabbath. It had to be something of an emergency. Jesus asked the question, is it lawful to do good or to do harm on the Sabbath? To do good is the answer. To save life or destroy? To save life is the answer. Then he called for the brother. He told him, stretch out your hand. And the withered hand at that point stretched out. The brother was healed. His withered condition went away. His witheredness was gone. And the text concludes by telling us that the crowd, the Pharisees and the scribes began to think of what they must do with Jesus. So, Pastor, what's the problem? What's the sermon about? Well, here we go. It hit me, beloved, that in this story, the brother that had the withered hand had it fixed. And the celebration, I guess you would say, for us is that somebody who had a problem had the problem solved by Jesus who fixed it. Are y'all here? The brother came to church, the synagogue. His hand was withered. He left. His hand was fine. He could praise God with his hand. He could go back to doing what he did before, the deformity, and everybody is happy. Imagine the excitement when he got home and began to show his family. Maybe he walked in with his hand still withered, and they asked him, how was church? He said, oh, you know, just a regular service, except look at this. Yeah, I wasn't there. The brother's withered hand was fixed. Here is the thing. In this miracle and in other miracles of Jesus, Jesus comes across as an ancient Ray Donovan. Preach, boy. You know Ray Donovan, the series Ray Donovan. Well, Ray Donovan comes on the scene. He is a fixer. If there's a problem, he shows up. He fixes the problem. He makes it all right. And then he goes somewhere else. Ray Donovan is a fixer. You know the story, the series Scandal. Olivia Pope was a fixer. If there was a problem, you called on Olivia Pope, and Olivia Pope was a fixer. Yeah. Jesus comes across as a fixer. But here is the problem I put before you. Or here is the question I place before you. Are we to take from this that Jesus is fixing folk, and that if you're broken, if there is a problem, if there is some kind of deformity, if there is something wrong, that you got to get that right before you come to Jesus. Get this, that if you come to Jesus, and if you have a withered condition, a withered situation, that Jesus is going to turn the withering around. That withering is not what Jesus values. And that those who have withered situations need to get healed of the withering, because that's the way Jesus operates. In other words, when you come to Jesus, he fixes what is wrong. And if he doesn't fix what is wrong, then maybe there's something else wrong with us. Because when Jesus shows up, Jesus as this fixer, as this healer, as the one who does all these things, Jesus fixes withered conditions. If your finances are withered, when Jesus shows up, money flows. If your health is withered, preach, boy, when Jesus shows up, healing occurs. If your relationships are withered, just call on Jesus, and Jesus will fix relationships. Whatever is wrong, Jesus fixes it. Here is the question I place before you. What would be the benefit? Talk, boy. If the story wasn't about Jesus restoring the withered hand of the brother, but Jesus going to the brother who had been living in shame, and Jesus embraced him, and Jesus affirmed him, and Jesus identified with him, so that when he left church that day and went back to his family, his hand may have still been withered, preach now, but his mind would have been all right. His hand would have still been the way it was before he left, but his mind would have been set free by the power of the love of Christ. I hear you. I hear what you're thinking. But Pastor, the text says the brother's hand was restored. Are you saying it was wrong for Jesus to restore the brother's hand? No. What I am saying, though, is wrong for us to think that when we come to Jesus, Jesus fixes what is wrong, because sometimes he will, but sometimes the withered condition stays. But when you have Jesus in your life and you know the love of Christ, even though the condition doesn't change, you are changed because you have experienced the love of God. My God, many of us have grown up thinking, whatever problem I have, Jesus is going to fix it. And here's the problem with that. We never come to know that Jesus loves you the way you are, and that with Jesus, withered hands, withered persons are welcomed. Not because he will always change the withering, but because he'll always love you in spite of. Preach now the withering. Not because when you come to him, he'll touch you, speak over you, declare something different about you, and all of a sudden the problem is fixed. No. Many of us have come to worship Sunday after Sunday, and the withering has not changed. But because we have been in the presence of a Savior who loves us unconditionally, and because we have been in the presence of a Savior who welcomes us as we are, because we have experienced the love of that Savior who loves us no matter what, even though the withering continues, we have experienced the love of Christ in such a way that the withering no longer is the main topic of our conversation. So yes, my right hand is withered, but I thank God that I got my left. I thank God I got my right mind. I thank God I know who I am. I thank God I'm loved and accepted. I thank God that Jesus loves me just the way I am. I've come to tell somebody, withered hands are welcomed by Jesus. Not as the first step to change your withering, but to change how you see yourself in the context of the withering. My time is up. If y'all didn't get much out of this today, well, you just know there's always next Sunday. But as a boy growing up, at the church I attended, there was always a ritual. The ritual didn't change a whole lot. The sermons did, for the most part. But the service began and ended the same way. After the preacher preached, after the word was delivered, and folk rejoiced in the presence of God, the choir, as the doors of the church were opened, and as persons were encouraged to connect to Jesus for themselves, the choir began to sing, "Just as I am, without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come. Just as I am, and waiting not to rid my soul of one dark blot, to thee whose blood can cleanse each spot, O Lamb of God, I come. Just as I am, though tossed about with many a conflict, many a doubt, fightings and fears within, without, O Lamb of God, I come. Just as I am, poor, wretched, blind, sight, riches, healing of the mind, yea, all I need in thee I find, O Lamb of God, I come. Just as I am, thou wilt receive, wilt welcome, pardon, cleanse, relieve, because thy promised, I believe, O Lamb of God, I come. One Sunday, as the choir sung that song, I made my way down the aisle. One Sunday, as they talked about this Savior who receives folk just as they are, I made my way to the altar. I gave my life to Christ. And I want to be transparent, and I want to be confessional. I was born left-handed. Left-handed folk weren't always valued. But I know there's a Savior who loved me left hand and all. I want to be transparent. There are some things that Jesus fixed, but there are some things he's taught me to live with. I want to be transparent. I know firsthand the healing power of Christ. But even more than the physical healing that Christ brings, I know the healing power Christ brings to my mind. That I can look myself in the mirror and love who I am just as I am. Withered hands. Woo. Are welcomed by Jesus. And the church will always be at its best when it can dare to welcome withered hands and give them a place to belong, witheredness and all. Withered hands are welcome. Woo! Thank God. Withered hands are welcomed. I done got myself excited here. Withered hands, broken, welcomed. Thank God, withered hands are welcomed. Let's pray. Oh, dear Savior, how thankful we are. Just as we are, we can come to you. You never turn us away. You never push us away. Help us to be freed from a fix-it Jesus mindset. And help us to incorporate into our thinking that even if it's not fixed, I am still welcomed and loved and accepted and valued. This is our prayer. I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, beloved, I want to say thank you again for joining us today for worship. Have a new sermon series coming up next week. You'll see about it on Facebook. Please invite someone even now to come and join us. We are excited about what God is going to do in the days ahead as we fall forward. Well, beloved, don't forget, now you have an opportunity to bless this ministry by sending in through the various platforms your tithe and your offering. You've heard the mission focuses all month long. We do what we do because of you, and we need you to continue to be faithful giving the tithe and the offering. You can use PayPal, Cash App. You can call Mr. Jarvis Miller. His number is on the screen. You can mail that to the church. You may even drop it off and put it in the mailbox. However you do it, just know we need your continued support. We cannot be the hands and feet of our Savior without you being, for us, the support that we need. So thanks in advance for all you do week after week. God loves you, and so do I. I want to say to you, I'm so thankful and proud of you proud of the St. Luke Missionary Baptist Church. I'm proud to be your pastor. And thank you for your big heart, your generous spirit, and touching the lives around the world. Well, God loves you, and so do I. And be thankful today that Jesus welcomes withered hands. He welcomes us as we are and loves us just the same. Well, beloved, God loves you, and so do I. Go with Christ. I'll see you next week. Have a great holiday weekend coming up. But wherever you are, you can still log in. Don't forget, we need you now more than ever. God loves you, and so do I. You take care. God's peace.
At the end of the day, the favor of God can open the way. God's favor is more precious than life.
More precious than life.
Ooh.